Are you okay?
Push down, hand by the neck. Just hang it down.
Down, there you go.
And then it's just the clothes on it. Okay, good.
Good morning, everyone. It's really good to see you all. We'll give Dylan a little break so he can get up there so he doesn't have to run quite so fast. You look outside this morning, there is no way in the world that you can ever doubt that there's a God. It's just absolutely beautiful. If you get on Facebook, there's a page called Science and Astronomy. Have some gorgeous pictures of northern lights and just things that happen in our universe that just really reinforces the presence of God. I'd like to welcome everyone here this morning. If you're visiting with us, if you would get one of these, hold your hand up and one of the guys will hand them to you or something like that, and fill that out as we go through the announcements and things. We'd like to have a record of your attendance, and you can just leave them in the pew when you leave if you care. Also, we have a prayer list on the flap of the bulletin, if you would be mindful of that and keep those people in your prayers this coming week and continuously, as well as anyone else you may know. As far as birthdays and anniversaries, we have no anniversaries again, but we do have some birthdays. On the 23rd is Greg Jensen, the 26th is Leanne Adams and Kimberly Mayo, and on the 27th is Cheyenne Lather. They're all pretty much here, so it seems odd and quick that we're to the back part of January already, but we're here. As far as activities for the coming week, on Wednesday is 9:30 is Ladies Prayer Group. So if you are part of that or like to be a part of that, that's when they meet. 3:45 is Circle J, and 6 o'clock is Choir. Again, if you'd like to be part of that, we'd love to have you. Friday from 12 to 1 is Ladies Fellowship. Then outside the office is the bulletin board with some opportunities for you to serve if you'd like to sign up. Whether you want to do nursery, children's worship, you want to sing a special during the week, during the month or something like that, you can sign up there. First Baptist Women's Ministry is collecting items for the Lighthouse during the month of January. And there's a list in the bulletin. There's already a stack started back there, so you can just add on to that as you want to, as you felt led to. Also, the ladies of the Board of Christian Ed Committee will be meeting up here in the front of the sanctuary right after church for a real quick meeting to discuss some details about a pie event we're going to have coming February the 11th. So you can get your appetites ready and get your pie cooking skills brushed up, and we'll do that February the 11th. But there will be more details about that coming. Also, today is Sanctity of Life Sunday. And on January 22nd, 1984, President Ronald Reagan proclaimed the third Sunday in January as the Sanctity of Life Sunday in the United States. And I'd like to read for you Psalms 139, then we'll have a little video right after that. And it says, "For you formed my inward parts, you covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Your eyes saw my substance, being yet unformed, and in your book they were all written, the days fashioned for me, when as yet there were none of them."
Thank you.
So we do know that God created us way before we were ever thought of. The children are learning a memory verse, so I'd like to support them in that at this time. It's Psalms 118:24, and if you'd repeat with me, "This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." So now. Father in heaven, we come before you this morning. We come here to worship you and to praise your name. We know you are a marvelous, wonderful, all-powerful God, and we thank you for blessing us. Thank you for allowing us to be your children. We know that you've made us, that you created us, just as you created the entire world. Before the world was made, you knew us by our name. We ask that you be with us this morning, be amongst us. Let us feel your presence as we worship you. Bless the words of our pastor this morning as he delivers your message, and be with us that we might receive from it as you wish for us to. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Now, if you'd stand as you're able, we'll sing our opening hymn, "How Great is Our God," and He is a great God. Scripture this morning is out of the book of Psalms, chapter 90, verses 1 and 2. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. You may be seated, please. And now John Paul will be sharing with us.
Well, back in March, I believe Pastor Matt had a series on 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 11 through 13. And verse 13 says, if we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. So he's even there, even when we fall away, to bring us back. He never goes against his commitment to us and wanting a relationship with us. So this is a very familiar hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is Thy Faithfulness, O God.
Strength for today.
and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness.
Thank you, John. It's a beautiful, beautiful song. Now, if you turn in your hymnal or watch on the screen, we'll sing our hymn of worship, hymn number 147. We'll sing verses 1, 3, and 4.
Oh,
how great you are. How majestic and complete are your works. You have made the entire universe, and you are Lord of all. Your strength is mighty and your tenderness is gentle. You have created each of us, and you know each and every one of us individually. You know our hearts and our minds. You knew each of us long before time began. You knew us before we were in our mother's womb, and you breathed life into us, and you have a purpose for our lives. We worship you, O God. You are our God, forever, O God. We thank you for loving us and blessing us. Many times we're so involved in the world we fail to see the many, many miracles you perform in our lives each day. Forgive us for our failure to see those miracles and give you the glory for them. We ask that you forgive us when we sin and fall short in our walk with you. And we ask you to show us your way and instill us in us the desire to serve you more. We pray for those on our prayer list this morning. We ask that you might heal them in your way. You know their needs, and you are the great healer. We pray for them. We ask for you to continue to bless our land, bless our families and loved ones. We ask for your continued guidance for our congregation's leadership and our congregation. Touch our lives. Fill us with your love as we share that love with others. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We will not be having a choir anthem this morning. We're a little short on personnel. We can't have a choir without people. So we will let the children, if they'd like to go to their worship service now, their Mrs. Brinkman will meet you back at the back of the sanctuary. And I did not neglected to do this at the beginning of the service, but Rob has brought his wife Barb with him this morning. So she's sitting over there next to him. She's keeping him in line and out of trouble. So if you greet her after church and make her feel welcome. So Rob, if you'd like to come, we are anxious to hear.
Sneeze or two has left the room. Poor kids. Ah. Good morning. I am delighted to have my wife Barb with me today. I've told her all 200 years. No, let's see, we've been married 45 this year. So we've known each other 47. And I keep saying things to her like, the woman has suffered enough, or I married up, or I can't believe you still like me. And
There's days.
That's exactly right, Vicki. Thank you. Vicki said that. There are days. She tried to put her head down and do it anonymously, but no. Something you guys don't know is that when a pastor is up here and he's looking out, we see. We see you when you're sleeping. We know. Yeah. So, have you noticed that we are in a world in which somebody has to get the blame? Whenever something happens, there has to be a blame. And it's not political. I can see it in my grandchildren. You know, when something goes wrong, it's like, Isn't that the way people are, though? People want to blame. And so the sermon today, we're going to ask the question, looking primarily in two passages, one in Romans 13 and one in James 1, about who's to blame and how our own sin nature tries to get us to compromise what God the Father, the Holy Spirit is working within us to bring us about to more of the image of Christ. And we talked just recently about the scripture in 1 Peter 2, where the word tells us to be holy because God is holy. And it's an instruction that in our humanity is impossible. It's like me telling you to go into your garage and become a car. I don't have the power to turn you into a car, but God does have the power. Through the shed blood of Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit and the Word, which are inseparable, by the way, to make you holy. In other places, the Word says, with man, this is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. And so, are you a blame person, do you think? Or are you a person looking forward to the impossibilities that God can bring about in your life? I really appreciated John's rendition of Great Is Thy Faithfulness, John. Thank you very much. It was beautifully done. But it also speaks very capably to the faithfulness of God who is at work within you. And we know in the Word that He tells us that He who began a good work in you will see it through to completion. And so we should never give up what our calling on our life is bringing us to be. My mind went blank for a moment. It's a little scary. So if you look at the scripture from Romans 13, up there, I'm going to read out of the Word and you can follow along there, and I'm going to include just a little bit more. Now, the Apostle Paul, in writing to the church at Rome, has given some tremendous instruction on the work of God in us and the faithfulness of God to us. And you remember, if we were to go back to Romans 8, the last paragraph of that chapter, which Romans 8, 28, we all know so very well, that he who began a good... Pardon me. And we know that in all things God is working together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. And we skip down to the end of that chapter, and Paul, in writing with that, also says, I'm convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any power, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And here, toward the end of this letter, what he is saying in Romans 13, he says, he's talking about submitting to authorities, talking about loving one another, and he says, and do this, understanding the present time. The hour has come for you to wake up from your slumber, because our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The night is nearly over. The day is almost here. So let us put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us behave decently, as in the daytime, not in orgies and drunkenness or sexual immorality and debauchery, nor in dissension and jealousy. Rather, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ, and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the sinful nature. Father God, we ask that today that you would move in our midst. We invite you to this place. We invite you to speak to us, to transform us, to awaken us, to strengthen us, to move in us for your glory. In Christ's name, amen. And so, today, I just want to talk to you a little bit about your sin nature. And a little bit about temptation. And if you, I don't know if you're like a history buff at all, but Thomas Edison is reported to have said, and I say reported because I wasn't there to hear it, but he was asked how he resisted temptation, and he said, I never have any. I don't have enough time. And so what he had done is he had filled his life in the pursuit of good things. Keep busy doing good, and you will not have time or thought for doing evil. Evil does not just come from your own nature. It also comes from outside us. We know that the enemy seeks, the word says in Peter that he goes around looking for those whom he may devour. So he's actively hating you and me because of Jesus and seeking to undo us. And in Matthew 12, the teaching there that the Lord gives says, when an evil spirit comes out of a man, it goes through arid places seeking rest and does not find it. And then it says, got an idea, I will return to the house that I left. And when it arrives, it finds the house unoccupied, big problem, swept clean and put in order. And then it goes and takes with it seven other spirits more wicked than itself, and they go in and live there. And the final condition of that man is worse than the first. That is how it will be, he says, with this wicked generation. When a house or a life is empty, it's wide open to anything. And we do not want to be empty, and we do not want to be available for evil. And so if we fill our lives with the goodness of God, with the holiness of God, with the power and the might of God, with the Spirit of God, you fill your heart with the Word of God, you spend time meditating on it in prayer and praise, then you will find yourself filled up with God and no room for evil. And so, that brings us to Romans 13 again. And do this, he says. Do what? Do the things that I just said to you about filling your life up with the things of God. The hour has come for you to awake from your slumber, because our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. Clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ. And do not think about how to gratify the sinful nature. Clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ. Put on. Now, if you look at yourself this morning, you look down, you see garments upon your person, on your body. Did they hang in the closet? And when you stood before them, did they jump onto your frame? Did these clothes that you're wearing choose by themselves to adorn you or to cover you? No. You put them on. And that is what we are to do, is to put on the things of God. One lady said, well, actually, it was a good friend of mine from Texas who was a preacher, and he used to say jokingly, I can resist anything but temptation. I'd say, Mike, are you hungry? Let's go. And he'd go, oh, I can resist anything but temptation. But what else is there to resist? By the way, Mike was a man of God, and he did resist temptation. What else is there to resist but temptation to sin? And what is it that sinning gets you. Or even just the temptation in your heart, in your mind. Materialism, pride, self-centeredness, laziness, anger, sexual lust, gluttony, lying, it could be anything. And the Word teaches that we are all tempted by something. And the temptation in and of itself is not the wrong thing. Temptation means you are still alive, and the enemy wants to corrupt and compromise you in your relationship with Christ. In Ephesians 2, the Word says, you know what, I have been neglectful. I have not been neglectful. Ephesians 2, as for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air. The Spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. And like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath when we were living in sin. The Word uses the phrase, you were dead in your trespasses and sin. Who is that? Well, it's everyone who has never believed in and trusted Christ for their salvation. At one time, we were all in sin because we lived according to the fleshly appetites and the ways of the world and the evil one who is at work in the world. But we still have the problem, do we not? We're still tempted to sin, and we must do something about those temptations. So, what must we do when we are tempted? And here we go. The first one is, when you are tempted, don't blame God. Don't blame God for your temptation. The Word says in verse 13, when tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. Job, when he was afflicted in so many ways, in Job 1:22, after he had lost his fields and his crops and his family and his house and all these things, Job did not sin by charging God with any wrongdoing. Now again, you may wonder, in all of what? In his losses, including the death of all 10 of his kids, he did not challenge or charge God with wrongdoing or blame God either. Many people would like to blame God for everything bad that happens to them. And that's incorrect thinking. God cannot be tempted by evil. Why is that? Because he is God. He is holy. He is pure. He is without sin. To be sinless is really pretty much beyond our comprehension. Wouldn't you say? We have sinned so much and so often we can't imagine anyone being without sin. C.S. Lewis wrote, how little people know who think that holiness is dull. When one meets the real thing, it's irresistible. It is not dull. God cannot be tempted to sin. Temptation holds no power over God the Father. And God does not tempt anyone. He will not tempt anyone. If this is true, then, why are we tempted to sin? It should be obvious to us that we live in a sinful world, a broken world, but God didn't break it. Man did. Consequently, there will always be temptation in the world, but it is not God's fault, even though he created the world. Secondly, when you are tempted, if you have to blame somebody, blame yourself. But each one is tempted when, by his own evil desires, he is dragged away and enticed. And then after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. The Word tells us in James 1 that each one is tempted by his own evil desire. Thomas Boston, who was a Scottish theologian from the 1600s, he said, temptation is the fire that brings up the scum of the heart. You know how metal is purified by fire? The attitudes of the heart are made evident by temptation. Do you ever read Reader's Digest? A guy wrote a letter. He said, when my wife and I were shopping in a mall, a beautiful young woman in an attractive dress strolled by, and my eyes followed her, the young lady. And without looking up from the item that the wife was examining, she said, now, was that worth the trouble you're in? Gentlemen, if you are tempted to let your eyes wander, the opposite direction premise is always relevant to you. If the situation arises this way, you automatically look this way. Or, with my wife sitting there, if that were to arise that way, my eyes would go that way. Can't you? Well, no, it's natural. You don't want to be natural, you want to be supernatural. Each one is tempted by his own evil desires. First John 2, the Word says, do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For everything in the world, the cravings of a sinful man, the lust of his eyes, the boasting of what he has and does, comes not from the Father, but from the world. The world and its desires pass away, but the man who does the will of God lives forever. The King James calls them the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. One preacher called these the three world goals. And most of the temptation we face in this life come from these. Lust for sensual pleasure, lust for things pleasing to the eyes or materialism, and pride of being appreciated, praised, or glorified. The word lust simply means you want it now. You want it now. You gotta have it. 1 Corinthians tells us, it is because of him that you are in Christ, who has become for us wisdom from God, that is our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let him who boasts, boast in the Lord. And so if there is anything about our lives, talents, gifts, material goods that appears good or great, it's because they are a gift from God. And he alone deserves the glory. When tempted, the Word teaches us to look up instead. Don't place blame on God. If you must blame yourself, but then look up. The Word says, don't be deceived, my dear brothers. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chose to give us birth through the Word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all of creation. In 1 Corinthians 10:13, the word tells us that no temptation has seized you, another version says taken you, except what is common to man, and God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can stand up under it. God provides a way out. Amen. In 1975, I was a freshman at the University of Arizona. And freshman load wasn't that heavy, so I was going to go to a movie. And a guy in the dorm said, there's this, and it was a naughty movie. I was going to go see some Disney thing that came out. I'm telling you the truth. And he said, well, buy the ticket for that one, but then sneak into this nasty movie. It was literally X-rated in the same theater. I still can't figure that out. But anyway, and he says, and tell me what it's like. And if it's good, I'll take my girlfriend to it. And I think back on that and I think, you creep. But when I had no intention of doing that. And when I got there, I bought my ticket for, I wish I could remember what it was. The Disney show, it had something to do with a dog. And I went in and sat down. In the dark, I could not see a thing. And I was being pulled to go to that other theater. And I was a new Christian, maybe 6 months. And well, my friend wants to know, so. And my heart already knew. How many times do we get tempted and we go, oh, well, I'll just check it out for a minute. And we already know. We already know. So, this is what happened. I went in and I sat down in the movie and I prayed, God, I need a way of escape. And when I sat down, the guy next to me in the seat elbowed me and he goes, Rob, what you doing? And it was the youth pastor from my church. And I started laughing. I said, oh man, do you know what you are? And he says, what? I said, you are an answer to prayer. And then I told him the whole story. A way of escape. You got to want the way of escape. But God will provide it. God himself is the way out and always provides a way out. Alexander was a little boy. He was saving up for a new baseball bat. He had a hard struggle. One night when he was saying his prayers, his mom heard him say, Lord, please help me save my money for the baseball bat. And please, God, do not let the ice cream man come down my street. Sometimes we may need to pray a similar prayer. Lord, keep me away from this, or keep those people or that activity away from me, and so on. 2 Timothy 2 says, flee the evil desires of youth. Pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. We must do everything that we can to keep from giving in to temptation to sin, and do everything we can to help others along the way. And so what we may want to ask ourselves is, Lord, what can I do to help others find salvation in you and to walk in that salvation myself? Lord God, you provide everything that we need. You're an awesome God. You make things possible. You give us all things. You give power when we need it. And we worship you today And we say, Father God, in the places where we are tempted, we ask you to provide a way of escape. Help us to be looking for the way of escape so that we might bring glory to you and testify to your goodness and faithfulness. In Christ's name, amen. A couple weeks ago, I was preaching out of the book of Peter. And it says that you are made new in Christ. You are a holy generation. You are a people after God. And I had wished that day that my wife would be able to be here to sing a song. And so since I found out she's going to be here today, we're going to sing that song now. And it fits that message then, but it fits today too. Do you want to be on my left? Because you're right behind me. You can be where you want. The neck will go to my left. We were in college together doing music, and I had a bass guitar that I played with that groove. And when I went to put it on, I conked her right on the top of the head. I got to confess something to you today, friends. I've been standing up here holding on to the pulpit because I can tell my blood sugar's low, and I'm a little bit dizzy, and I hope I got through that sensibly here, you step this way.
See, call out through the rain.
God bless you all. Catch me on the phone.
Thank you, Bob. Barb and Bob, beautiful song. Now if you stand, we'll sing our closing hymn, Make Me a Blessing. First verse. That you might imprint them within our hearts, make them part of our lives. Let us be part of our minds as we go throughout this coming week. We thank you for the blessings. We thank you for what you do for us each and every day. For it's in Jesus' name.